Say, would you please bow your head for just a moment? Father, again, we recognize that you are the God of all comfort. And we ask, Father, today that you would comfort each and every person that has a sense of loss and grief. You said that your grace is sufficient, and we pray that your grace would flow to every person in this place, every person who's watching. We pray, Father, that you would comfort them, that you would strengthen them. And Father, we thank you today for Ken's life. We thank you, Father, that we know that now he is in your presence, because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And we thank you for that, that we are not like those that don't have hope, because we know that if you raise Jesus, you will raise those who have received him as well. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, it was almost 20 years ago that Ken came to serve here at Resurrection Life Church. He was at that time part-time at Madison, and we needed somebody who was older, who had some talent, but also some leadership skills. And we were able to talk with Ken, and he and Andrea agreed to come. And honestly, when he came more as a talent. But as we served together, and I got to know Ken, he became a friend. He became a really good friend. His character and his integrity just caused him to just rise to the top in our leadership team. And he was such a blessing and a mentor to so many young people that were his peers and people that were older than Ken. He became a mentor to them. And one of the things that I always appreciated about Ken was he had Jesus' heart. Jesus said, I didn't come to be served, but to serve. And that is just a picture of Ken. He came to serve. And he was just a servant in the kingdom of God. And it was such a privilege to get to serve with him. And again, just talking about his character, everybody respected Ken. And he was such a great leader. In leadership, you need to be able to relate with the people that are above you. He was incredible. You needed to be able to relate with the people that were your peers, that were on the team, and he was incredible. And you needed to be relate to people that you were overseeing, and he was incredible. He was just such a man of integrity. We had the same heart. There was one time in 20 years, he said, Pastor, he said, everything you've ever done, I could explain to people. But this one thing that you did, he said, I couldn't explain it. Now, I want to say something. How many of you know everybody needs people in their life that will tell them the truth? And Ken didn't back off. He said, you know, I don't understand this. And we talked and we agreed to disagree. Right? But we all need somebody. We don't need people that are going to say, hey, whatever. We need the people that are going to call us out. And Ken, he lifted our church. He lifted our worship. He lifted us spiritually. And he was just a tremendous, tremendous blessing in the kingdom of God. A delight to work with. And I would say with all integrity, it was one of the great privileges of my life to serve with Ken, to serve in the kingdom. I want to share a few scriptures before I pass this position on today. In 1 Thessalonians 4 and 13, it says, I don't want you to be ignorant, brethren. It's always interesting to me, wherever the Bible tells us not to be ignorant, it's where they're the most ignorant. It says, concerning those who have fallen asleep or those who have died, lest we sorrow as others that have no hope. I haven't traveled the world, but I've been in Asia and Europe and Russia and South America and lived in Latin America. I've been in several countries, and I've literally seen people jump in caskets and shake dead people and scream. But we're not like that, because we have hope. Because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, I believe it, even so God will bring with him those who sleep or who have died in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede or go ahead of those that have died. For the Lord Jesus himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. You know, when you know that we have Ken's physical body here, but we know that the real Ken is not there. See, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23 says, may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless to the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice the Bible says that you and I, we are a trichotomy. We have three parts, spirit, soul, and body. The spirit is the real person that you are. And it's with your spirit that you can contact the spiritual realm. Your soul is really, in just one word, it's your intellect. And with it, we can contact the intellectual realm. And our body, which is simply the house that your spirit lives in, right? And with that, we can contact the physical realm. The Bible says, as the body without the spirit is dead. The real reason that my arms are moving is because my spirit's saying move. But if the spirit was gone, the body would do nothing. So the real person that you are is a spirit. Jesus said in John chapter 4 that God is a spirit. Now, you're not God, you never will be. But you're the same class of being, a spiritual being. Hebrews 1 says he makes his angels spirits. Angels are spirits. Now, I do want to ask you a question here. Do angels retire when they're 300,000 years old? Because spirits don't get old. See, the Bible says the outward man perishes. My physical body perishes. I used to do things when I was 25. I don't do now that I'm 68. The physical body is perishing. It's getting old. But the inner man is renewed day by day. So really what I've got is I've got a 25-year-old me stuck in a 68-year-old body. And a lot of you know exactly what I'm talking about. Because your body's gotten old, but your spirit hasn't gotten old. Because spirits don't get old. See, because every spirit will live someplace forever. You got that? Every spirit. God's a spirit. He's never going to die. Angels are spirits. They're never going to die. And you are a spirit. Your body will die. But the real you that lives on the inside will step out. You know, Jesus really, he took the veil and he ripped it back when it comes to life after death. He tells this in Luke chapter 16. He says, there was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate, desiring to be fed from the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. So it was, the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom or Abraham's side. So the beggar died. They took his body, and I'm sure they put it in a pauper's grave. But the angels carried him. See, you're not your body. You're not your mind. You're a spirit. And when your body dies, the spirit that lives on the inside is going to step out. Sunday morning, Ken's body died, but the real Ken stepped out. And faster than the speed of light, angels carried him into the presence of God. To be absent from the body for the believer is to be present with the Lord. The angels carried him to Abraham's side. Then it says, the rich man also died and was buried. He probably had a very, very elaborate tomb that he had prepared for himself. But the Bible says, being in torment in Hades, he lifted up his eyes. He saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried out, saying, Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in torment in this flame. Now, notice the rich man, he's been buried, but he's in Hades. His body's in the grave, but he's in a place called Hades. And he lifts up his eyes, and he sees Lazarus, and he recognizes him. Some people wonder, well, we know people when we get to heaven. Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm going to talk about that in a few moments. You're going to know them. He said, put the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. So many people don't recognize this, but you not only have a physical body, you have a spiritual body. God is a spirit. So I'm going to ask the question, does God have a body? Nobody's answering. The answer is yes. Moses said, I want to see your glory. So God put him in the cleft of the rock and put his hand over the spot. And God passed by and Moses saw God's back. So does God have a body? But it's not a physical body. It's a spiritual body. Right? Your spirit has a body. And you say, what does it look like? It looks like you. See, because the rich man lifted up his eyes. Now, how many of you know if you have eyes, you have a head? And if you've got a tongue, you have a mouth. And if you've got a finger, you've got a hand and an arm and a body that it attaches to, right? See, we have this idea when we die that all of a sudden everything is going to be totally, totally different than what it is right now. But the Apostle Paul shared this in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. He said, I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether in the body or out of the body, I don't know. God knows how such a man was caught up to heaven. I know such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I don't know. God knows how he was caught up into paradise and heard inexpressible words, which is not lawful for a man to utter. Now, so I'm going to ask you a question. If you went to Myers and left your body home, would you miss it? Probably not. Because Paul said, I went to heaven, and I don't know if I had my body with me or not. Only thing I'm sure of is I went to heaven, and I heard and saw things that I'm not even allowed to talk about. See, we think when we die, everything's going to be totally different, but you're going to feel just as much alive. In fact, the truth is you're going to be more alive the moment that you die than you probably have ever been in your entire life. Dwight L. Moody, the great evangelist of the 19th century, said this, realizing that he would soon be gone from this world, he said to a friend, someday you will read in the papers that Dwight L. Moody of Northfield is dead. He said, don't you believe a word of it. He said, at that moment, I shall be more alive than I am now. I should have gone higher, and that's all. Out of this old clay tenement, into a house that is immortal, a body that sin cannot touch, that sin cannot taint, a body fashioned unto his glorious body. Ken was born May 13, 1966, but he stepped into the eternal God realm on August the 8th, 2021. The Bible says we do not lose heart. For even though the outward man is perishing, the inward man is renewed or made new every day. Amen. I believe that. You don't get old on the inside. The Apostle Paul said, I'm hard pressed between two. I have a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. It's not a little better, it's far better. If we gave Pastor Ken the opportunity to come back right now, I believe that he would say, I love you guys, but this is amazing. This is far better. This is the place the Bible calls the better country. I want you to remember this. The Bible says that death is the last enemy that will be destroyed. Death is no friend. It is no friend. It's an enemy. But if Jesus tarries, every one of us, our body will get old and wear out, and we'll step out of that body into the eternal realm. Paul said, the time of my departure is at hand. He said, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith. When I was thinking about Ken's graduating to heaven, this was the verse I thought of. He fought the good fight. He finished his race, and he kept the faith. He said, Paul said, my departure is at hand. The word departure there, it's a nautical term. Right? And you never leave one spot without knowing where you're going. When Ken left here, he knew where he was going. William Wilberforce, the great emancipator for all of England and their possessions, spent his life fighting slavery. The friend of John Newton. In fact, John Newton mentored Wilberforce. Most of us just know Newton by the song that he wrote, Amazing Grace. But he said, now I feel so weary from earth and my affections so much in heaven that I can leave you all without regret. Yet I do not love you less, but I love God more. But I love God more. And Ken, he's in heaven. He's in God's presence today. And we are confident that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
Will everyone please stand? Stand with us and celebrate the life and the legacy. You are God alone. There is no one like you. There is no one like you, Father. Your mercy has been shown. Your love so undeserving. Love so undeserving.
Power is within us. The power is within us. You can't. Thank you. our hiding place, God, that we can run to and be saved. If you know this song, would you sing it with us? I'm not afraid.
I'm not afraid. You are with me.
You are with me.
You are with me. Lead me, Lord.
My refuge.
My refuge. I will follow.
I will follow.
I will follow.
So here I am.
Here I am.
Worship you today. Bless your name, Jesus. Giver of life.
Giver of life.
I will trust you.
I will trust you.
Yes.
I will trust you.
Take my hand.
Take my hand.
My shepherd.
My shepherd.
I will follow.
I will follow.
Will follow. I'm
not afraid.
You bring us safety. We run to you, for you are our hiding place. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Good morning, church family. It's times like these that we need one another, our brothers and sisters in Christ. And so we join here today to celebrate life, a life well lived, and honor a man who is deserving of that honor. A resolution was also provided by New Hope Baptist Church, and on behalf of the family, they want to thank you for your thoughtful support during this difficult time. And also the family wishes for you to know how much they appreciate all the support, the love, the meals, the cards, and prayers that have gone up on their behalf. And now, this is Ken's life song, Prelude. On a hot spring day on Stead Air Force Base in Amarillo, Texas at 9:21 p.m., Kenneth Leon Reynolds marched his way into the world. On May 13, 1966, Ben and Barbara welcomed Kenneth into their lives with great joy. The three of them enjoyed their time in Amarillo until Ben was honorably discharged from the United States Air Force. Kenneth was 13 months old when the family returned to Michigan. Kenneth started preschool at age 4, beginning his academic journey. At an early age, he was beating on his mother's pots and pans and pattern books. This is where his appreciation for music began. Living in a home that was filled with many genres of music, it became evident to his parents that God was developing his passion for music. At the age of 7, Kenneth was baptized at New Hope Baptist Church under the leadership of Reverend John V. Williams. From that moment on, his love for worship began and was reflected in his involvement with the Cherub Choir, God's Chosen Ones, Inspirational Choir, and the Senior Choir. His strongest musical influences during this time were his beloved Aunt Alma Perry and devoted father, Ben Reynolds. Verse 1. In 1975, Kenneth made his first public appearance in the Grand Rapids Press when his drum solo won first place in the Delta Sigma Theta Jabberwock Community Talent Contest. In addition to Kenneth's musical talents at the age of 12, he was a school safety crossing guard and a published author with the story, The Strange Eggplant. Kenneth maintained perfect attendance throughout his school years, demonstrating his commitment to excellence and strong work ethic. Throughout Kenneth's school years, he participated in the jazz, symphonic, and marching bands, being first chair percussion at Wyoming Park High School. He illustrated his love for community through his induction into the National Honor Society. His high school musical career culminated when the Wyoming Park High School Marching Band won the Governor's Trophy Award, Best in State. Verse 2. After graduating high school in 1984, Kenneth attended Western Michigan University, where he continued marching through life towards his future aspirations. He spent his summer serving his community as a percussion instructor for several award-winning area bands. Being a multifaceted musician, Kenneth played bass or drums for Western's Gospel Choir, the Eternal Life Kalamazoo Community Choir, and WMU Gold Company. In 1988, he graduated with a Bachelor of Science degree in Business Administration and a minor in Music. Chorus. In August of 1989, Kenneth met the co-writer of his life song, Andrea Denise Weekly. From the music pit at church, Kenneth looked up and saw a bright light in the soprano section of the choir. They went out for ice cream, and the rest was history. 2 years later, on August 31st, 1991, Kenneth and Andrea marched their way into wedded bliss. Hand in hand, they greeted parenthood with the birth of Kent and Charles Reynolds, better known as K. Ray Jr., on December 30th, 1996, and then again on July 8th, 2000, with the birth of Alyssa Denise Reynolds, affectionately known as Liss. Their favorite things to do as a family included traveling, going to movies, dancing around the house, and going to the symphony. Through the years, Ken and Andrea spent a lot of time being the number one fans of their kids at sporting and creative arts events. Together, they met life's highs and lows, all while placing God at the center of their family. Bridge. Ken spent over 10 years using his business degree working in the sales services department at Steelcase. During this time, Ken began to cultivate his love for worship and leading others into the presence of the Lord. He spent his lunch hour writing songs on napkins, returning home, and staying up late creating melodies. He was influenced by many great artists from diverse genres: James Cleveland, Morris Chapman, Walter Hawkins, Ron Canole, The Winans, Commissioned, Kenny G, Michael Jackson, Earth, Wind, and Fire, Victor Wooten, Rachmaninoff, Chopin, and more. Ken's love for music ministry encompassed writing and directing for the James Family Singers, which consisted of his parents, siblings, aunts, uncles, and cousins. The family traveled all over the Midwest area, spreading the gospel. This anointed family continues singing even today, and with his own children and nieces. In 1994, Ken and his cousin Gerald Perry co-founded the gospel group His Image, formerly known as Direction. This group consisted of young men from various Christian denominations and included Brian Lowe, Craig Tyson, Terry James, Henry Sapp, Joseph Burrell, and Calvin Dukes. They recorded two albums and had a video played on BET's Video Gospel, signing with Inner Court Records. Ken accepted the call into part-time music ministry at Madison Square CRC, where he was the worship leader. Under his leadership, Madison's praise teams and choirs evolved. It was during his tenure at Madison that Ken's international influence expanded, and he recorded two albums. In 2001, Ken left the business world behind and entered into full-time ministry, joining Reslife Church as a worship pastor. For the last 20 years, Ken has had the honor of serving the ministry in various leadership roles, the most recent being Operations Leadership Team and worship pastor. During this time, Pastor Ken has mentored musicians and new worship pastors, served the congregation fulfilling various pastoral duties, and produced and recorded several solo and church projects. Pastor Ken established relationships with record labels that resulted in recording contracts with Integrity and Dream Capital Records. Although he performed with many groups at various high-profile events around the world, one of his greatest joys was worshiping with his home team at Reslife. Outro. Pastor Ken is preceded in death by his grandparents, Oscar and Irma James Sr., and Reverend Benjamin Reynolds Sr. Great-grandparents in love, Francis Barber, and Charles and Mamie Weekly Sr., Aunt Alma and Uncle Robert Perry, Aunts Mary James and Willa James, and Brother in Christ, Brian Lowe. He leaves to cherish his memory, his loving wife of almost 30 years, Andrea, son, Kenton Charles K. Ray Jr., and daughter, Alyssa Denise Liss. Parents, Ben and Barbara Reynolds, and parents in love, Charles and India Weekly. Sister, Beverly Elaine Shannon, and brother, Troy Durand Reynolds. Nieces, Brooke and Camille Shannon, Tiana and Julia Reynolds. Aunts and uncles, Oscar James Jr., Marvin James, Jerome and Jean James, Coleman and Asanya James, Marvis and Brenda James, and Lamar and Sylvia James, Roland and Beverly Barber, and Frank and Diane Barber. Cousins, Michael and Danielle James, Mark and Trisha James, Tony and Natalie James, Terry and Pixie James, Reginald and Nancy James, Tanya and Cedric Walker, Deborah Perry, Gerald and Nanette Perry, Eric and Denise James, Kimberly and Mark Smith, Christy and Corey Stokes, Brian and Audrey James, Ramey and Jason Littleton, Kamisha and Earl Jackson, Aaron James, Orlando James, and Courtney and Jessica James, Tracy and Roland Barber, Alan and Margaret Barber, Kevin and Colleen Barber, Donna and Todd Ball, Kathy and Jeff Roberts, Teresa and Dana Getman, Jessica and David Tumusime, Venachi Cunningham, Janelle Casper Cunningham, and Dwayne and Monica Cunningham. Brothers in Christ, Michael Barbie, Rick Norder, and a host of many close friends. In Pastor Ken's own words, and I quote, "Pastor John V. Williams held me up at age 4 and said that I was going to write songs. That prophecy came to pass." We love you, Ken.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. All I have need is thy hand has provided.
I know that knowledge.
Great is thy faithfulness, man. Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness.
Y'all already back there.
Oh, great thy faithfulness.
I think about it now through the years, 55
years. All I have need, thy hands have, my God has provided.
Come on, say it with Tony.
Great is thy faithfulness.
Come on, everybody.
Great is thy faithfulness.
I know y'all know what Reslife.
Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, Byron
Coleman, Lord, and Sister Weekly,
Lord, to me.
I was thinking as I was riding about here, Lamar,
This is all. This is for us. Every Saturday, Gerald. Every Saturday, 12 o'clock, Gene. We'd hit it. This is just normal for us. Ken, a blessed man of God, man that loved God. Barbara Ben, you need to know, he's a train of a child in the way it should go, and when it grows older, won't depart from him. He did not. Andre, you've been there. You've been there for him. But we're just going to sing a couple of songs. Can I go back to 882 Caulfield? Can I go back there? Y'all don't know about 882 Caulfield. But this is where it's all started. This is when Ken walked in with a little raggedy little guitar. Bring it up a little bit.
In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, say it on. Tell me, who can stand me for us when we
call?
What?
Come on, y'all.
Jesus, who is it to you?
Blessed is all you.
my God, to pray.
Yeah.
you better give God some praise out there. You better give him some praise out there. This man has walked a wonderful life. And when I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he has done for me, my soul cries out. Hallelujah.
I'm going to read from the Old Testament, and this was one of Ken's favorite verse, Proverbs 3, 5 through 6. I'm reading from the NIV. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not in your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him, and he'll make your paths straight. Another one of his favorites was Psalm 23. It says, I'm going to read the whole chapter, so bear with me. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right path for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I'll fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. If there's one thing I could say, I had this said once, but I never knew what it meant. So many greats have graced this world and left great. But so few greats leave others greater than they found them. Ken, you made us better.
Good morning. I don't have to tell you that. Good afternoon. Ken was a special man. He indeed was a special person, and nobody but Ken could bring us together and give us a glimpse of heaven on this Saturday afternoon. Truly special. My family and I relocated to the Grand Rapids area over 15 years ago. We moved into a neighborhood. Our son was about 4 years old. At the time, when he was about 5, he wanted to have a lemonade stand. And so we went through the painstaking chore of making lemonade, finding cups. He had a little table, was out at the end of the driveway. There was a guy that would drive up and down our street. He lived in our neighborhood. We found out he was Ken Reynolds. Ken had the longest fingers. And whenever he passed by, you'd see his fingers. I know we all know of Ken's singing gift and his music gift, his ministry gift, but Ken was special. This particular day, he stopped and he was Zachary's first customer. He bought lemonade. They took a picture together. I wish I had it to show you today, but that's my fondest memory of Ken, of not taking anything away from the music. But it was his heart for children that stood out most to my wife and myself, that he loved children. But not only was Ken just a lover of people, lover of children, we know of his music gift, but he was equally gifted in terms of exposition, exegesis. He had a pastor's mind, a preacher's mind, and a phenomenal gift. And I just want to thank God for Ken Reynolds. I want to thank God for Andrea and the family for being such exceptional people and great neighbors as well. The New Testament scripture, I'm going to read it from the Message Bible. John chapter 14, the first six verses says, "Don't let this throw you. You trust God, don't you? Trust me. There's plenty of room for you in my Father's home. If that weren't so, would I have told you that I'm on my way to get a room ready for you? And if I'm on my way to get your room ready, I'll come back and get you so you can live where I live. And you already know the road I'm taking." Thomas said, "Master, we have no idea where you're going. How do you expect us to know the road?" Jesus said, "I am the road, also the truth, also the life. No one gets to the Father apart from me." Amen.
It is so wonderful to see so many people here to celebrate my father. We've been talking about how much, you know, he meant to everybody, how great of a pastor he was, how great of a friend he was, but he was an amazing, amazing father and husband, cousin, uncle. I kind of said I was going to kind of free flow this, but, you know, my name is Kenton. My dad's full name was Kenneth, but, you know, we all call him Ken. And, you know, with my name being Kenton, you know, K-E-N-T-O-N, I guess that would mean I'm a ton of Ken. and I could not be happier. I could not be happier. But I just kind of wanted to share with you guys just a few things. Obviously, there's a lifetime of memories, you know, that we have, and he will always live with us. But there's just a few memories that I want to share within the past couple months of him going through this journey. You know, I was talking with my mom and my sister, and you've seen, you know, some posts that we've been sending out, and he was just amazing, guys. He was just amazing. My mom would always talk about how nightly routine, you know, he would turn off the lights for her, and you know, she would get in bed and she would start falling asleep, and he would get up and, you know, take her glasses off her face and plug her phone in, because you know that battery was low. That was a low battery phone right there. But he would give her a kiss on the forehead every night and tuck those covers up all the way up because she likes to be warm. And that's what she shares with people now who ask how she's doing. And, you know, she's the best mother anyone can ask for. But as a father, though, he was really cool. He was a cool dad. He was a cool dude. And it's cool and funny, too, because he's, as much as he is outgoing, he also is really, really smooth about things. He's never super, he doesn't go fly off the handle, really. He's always chill. He's super, super chill. And I always admire that about him. And it was a little more difficult these past couple months because, you know, a lot of the medication he had to take, you know, kind of made him not so chill. He had to, you know, he started expressing a lot more. He started really saying what was in his mind. And just, I remember the last conversation that I had with him when he was still able to speak and, you know, talk well. I've been going through a job change and, you know, I got a job offer and I was excited, I wanted to tell him, you know, he was in the hospital, he was in the bed. And, you know, I had the chance to kind of, you know, pick a computer, you know, that I wanted. And I was like, hey, Dad, you know, I got the offer letter. It looks good. They're giving me the money I need to get this computer. It's going to be really, really great. And he was like, oh, okay, that's awesome. That's awesome. What are you thinking? And so he and I started talking back and forth. And he's like, what about this one? You know, I'll look up this, look up that. He was always a researcher. He researched everything all the time. If you ever had a question, you were like, what do you think about this? What do you think about that? He's like, oh, let me research it. And he sends you like five links to like Amazon, the actual manufacturer's website, maybe once like Walmart or Target. You know, like he's one of those guys, right? But we were just looking and looking. And, you know, after we did all of that and we found a great one, he was like, that one's good. I was like, yep, that one has what I need. And then he also told me to go for it, go and accept that job, that letter. And I was like, okay. And, you know, I started leaving and I said, I love you, Dad. He said, I love you too. And that was the last conversation that I had with him. But on my way back home on the highway, my mom called me on the phone and she said, hi, son, I just wanted to let you know that, you know, your dad, as soon as you left, he looked up and he was like, where'd he go? And my mom was saying how he was worried and wondering, you know, did we figure it out? Did we get it? Oh man, I let my son down. We didn't find it. We didn't get it. And my mom was like, no, Ken, honey, you found it. He's going to accept. You found the computer. You guys worked together on it. And that was just one of those moments where I was like, wow, you know, if that was something that he was really, you know, hiding in his heart, something that was deep in there, for it to be let out like that, that is a true loving father. Really quick too, I know we're pressed for time a little bit, but I just wanted to share just even a little bit of the last, you know, couple days in the hospital with him and my family. It's my mom, my sister, me, and some friends. We were in the hospital and they were only allowing two people in the room at a time. And so the last night, my mom and I were like, okay, we're gonna do this. We're gonna get our gowns on, everything that they needed for, you know, safety, protection, whatever, right? We were like, we're gonna go in there. We are going to go to battle with Dad. And we brought the Bible. We brought a whole bunch of books that have words of life in them to speak over him. And he was, you know, plugged up to so many different things. And for that whole night, my mom and I, we were speaking words of life to him. We were praying for him. And in the middle of that night, sometime there, I put out a call to prayer. And so many of you responded with pray emojis. You know, we're praying for you, healing in the name of Jesus. We saw so many. And I read each and every one of those to him. And I said, who wrote it? I said the name, because Facebook has the name. I said it. And he can hear everything, right? He was able to hear. He couldn't respond, but he heard it. And he fought. He fought, guys. He was a fighter. He was strong, and he fought. And towards the end, you know, it wasn't looking good, and we had the doctor's reports, but we knew we also wanted God's report, right? So we went in there with our whole family, got together. There was like 20, 25, 30 of us in that room, all gowned up. And We were praying for a miracle, and we were singing his favorite songs. And, you know, we were praying for a miracle, we were praying for healing, and the doctor said one thing, but we knew that it was going to be another. One way or another, it was going to be another. So, the last song that we sang to him was his latest song that he has written, and it's called Believe. And it's based off of that psalm that David said earlier, Psalm 23. It was one of his favorite verses, and it came to him in this battle. The last time he fought it and beat it, it came to him. And I think God gave him the strength and everything he needed to write that song and produce that song so that it can go out to the world, so that the world will know his story and his battle and his victory. And I was like, we need to sing this. We have to sing this as that song. We have to. And we did. And midway through the song, he was fully healed. He was fully healed midway through that song. But it wasn't by our standards. It was by God's. And with that song, 2 years ago, he was writing it. He pretty much finished it. He said, hey, son, I know we're going out to California. I want this to be a music video. I want to go out somewhere. I want to just record and just sing it. And I want you to do the video. And I said, okay, Dad, let's go. Let's go. And we just went out and had so much fun walking on beaches, walking through the forests, and just hanging out. And it was so amazing. And I knew right away that I needed to do something, because I had all that footage, and he was still trying to master it and get it perfect. You know how he was. He's a perfectionist. It's got to be perfect. But he did. He made it perfect for what it needed to be. And I had the footage, and I put something together that I would like all of you guys to watch. It was one of the last things that he wanted me to do for him. So, here is Belief.
Fear no evil, the best is yet to come.
Thank you, Kenton, for putting that together. That's sweet. So last Sunday morning, I had the privilege of standing with Andrea as Ken had gone to be with the Lord, and we stood there together and thanked God for his life. And then she asked me if I would share at his funeral. I don't like doing the funeral of my friends. I don't like this. I would rather Ken be standing beside me. But in God's hemisphere, he does stand with us today. He is here. I need to give you a little bit of a backdrop. When Andrea asked me to share, you know I'm a preacher, I love to preach, but I never know exactly what I'm going to share in a funeral, and especially a close friend. A guy who loved the Lord, a dude who loved his family, loved you, Andrea, Kenton, and Alyssa. I would just tell you, look around. All these people you see around and behind you and hugging you and all that stuff, we all love you guys. We just all love you guys. And so I began to work on what I wanted to share. I began to try to put some things together. It just kind of was falling, it just kind of falling out. Yeah, that's not it. But you need a little bit of a backstory. So about 20 years ago, I was in Australia, and I woke up, and I thought I was having a heart attack. And I actually woke my son up. He was 14, 15 at the time. And I said to him, Alan, we were out in the woods in Australia. And I said to him, dude, get me in a car, get me somewhere. Your dad's having a heart attack. And he woke up, and he looked at me, and he said, okay. And then he fell right back asleep. And I was like, what kind of kid is this? And the Lord began to speak into my spirit saying, you're not having a heart attack. I'm trying to get your attention. And I began to write down what the Lord was saying, and I wrote several pages. And when I finished the last page, my heart didn't hurt. I was complete. I felt as clean and clear as I do right now. It was crazy. And so from that day forward, when the Lord wakes me up at 3:30, I mean, I literally wake up like, what time is it? I look over, 3:30 on my clock. Tuesday morning, after Andrea had asked me to speak on Sunday morning, and I had battled within myself, what am I going to say? At 3:30 on Tuesday morning, the Lord woke me up, and he gave me what I'm going to read to you today. He woke me up with these words. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Job 121. On May the 13th, 1966, the Lord gave a little boy named Kenneth Leon Reynolds to Ben and Barbara Reynolds. As Pastor said, his fingers would be long and his melody would be strong. His heart would be in tune with the rhythm of the King. And his life would be used to create songs to bring glory and worship to the great I Am. On August 31st, 1991, the Lord gave Andrea Denise Weekly a gentleman husband, strong in commitment, dedicated to love and care and walk with his queen. That's what he called her. For the next almost 30 years, August 31st would be 30 years. Always his queen was his words, and she held his heart. On December the 30th, 1996, the Lord gave Kenton Charles Reynolds a dad who believed in him, a dad who was dedicated to him. The same hands that changed your diaper have now guided you into your career. A dad dedicated to raising this son to bring honor and glory to the Lord God Almighty. And today, just a few moments ago, you watched that son take the baton. Live it up, bro. Live it up.
live it up.
On July the 8th, in the year 2000, God gave Alyssa Denise Reynolds a daddy. A daddy who loved his baby girl. His princess. Their bond would be unbreakable. His love and laughter caught and held in her spirit, and it lives on in her today. If you have not yet read her post about her father, you need to go today and read it, because in it he lives on. And even now, every one of us in this room knows the one who comes to attempt to match this love better be ready. Lord bless that guy. On October the 1st in 2001, the Lord gave Reslife a one-of-a-kind worship leader. A man full of faith and full of soul. And he was able to blend the two. The Lord gave. And on August the 8th, early in the morning, the Lord took away. The Lord took from this world a man full of wisdom and godliness and holiness, and God in his infinite wisdom took him and gathered him to be with himself. Ken would say to those who would say his life was cut short, he would say, I lived a full life, full of God's goodness, full of love for my family, and full of love for all of us. We have come here today to celebrate his life. We have come to remember his dignity, his integrity. And here's what Ken Reynolds did with his days. Number one, Ken walked with God. Number two, Ken brought peace to those around him. Number three, Ken served faithfully. And number four, Ken has now been gathered to his people. Because the Lord, in his infinite wisdom, decides when we go. This is what life is all about. If every one of us have the things that are being said about Ken Reynolds said about us when our final day is passed, I want to tell you, you have lived a good life. He has set an example for us all. But I would be amiss today if I did not take a moment and talk about Ken's classy swag. Ken has swag. And I feel I can only do that appropriately if I wear this. When Ken and I did cruises together, we had matching hats. After this day, this hat will be laid to rest. I will put it in my office, I will hang it at a place, and I will live the rest of my days looking over and remembering when we did crazy stuff on cruises together. Ken was smooth. Ken could sing the Lord's Prayer and close it out with an earth, wind, and fire tag. Ken had beats in him long before Dr. Dre put it on a headphone. Ken could drag things out. I'd say to Ken sometimes when we did a big event together, Ken, everything needs to be ready in about 5 minutes. You got to be on stage and going in 5 minutes. He would kind of go, well, you just assured yourself it's going to be about 15. We have not seen heaven yet, but Ken knew how to bring us right to the edge of the door. And I would tell you that all I got to do is look at y'all today
and prove a point by saying, does anybody here want to praise the Lord with me? I think about the first time that song must have popped in his head. What did he do? He probably pulled it down and went, that's going to be a good one. He has swag. He brought Rez Life swag. A lot of y'all are tending here because of the way he swagged. And that brings me to my main point today. Ken used all his swag to bring honor and glory and praise to his Creator. He did not bring glory to himself. Ken brought glory to God Almighty. God blessed him with talents, and he knew who they belonged to. And he gave those talents to the Lord. It was standing on this very stage not long ago that Ken said these very words. I read them. I quote him. He said, I'm standing here today because God is good. And in that mental challenge, he said, of my battles, I wasn't going to yield to the voice of the enemy. There are many times when I could have given up, but I was determined to stand on the faith that I sing about every week. And in the midst of that journey, God gave me these words to the song from the book of Psalms. And it was a comfort to me. In the chorus, it says, you are God, you are good, you're right beside me. Through the valley, you're always here. You promised, and I believe. Ken believed in what he sang about. Ken called us to believe in the Creator who made us all. I was with Ken many times. And one of the things that I recall and have recalled in the last few days that have stood very strong out to me is how Ken never spoke bad of anyone. I'm telling y'all, I don't know if y'all notice in our world, but that's kind of unheard of. Ken did not speak. He might, like, if I said a certain thing or brought up a certain name or someone that had caused some friction, some contention, some issues, this is what Ken would do. He would just look and go. No words came out, just a little. You know, I can read the body language. But he wasn't going to say anything bad about anybody. Can we all learn a lesson from that? What would happen today if we took the new command that Jesus gave us? Pastor read earlier from John chapter 14. John chapter 13, just a bit earlier, says this, a new command I give you, love one another. To all in this room, I ask you, what would happen if we lived here and just loved one another? How much forgiveness would be given? How much grace would be offered? You said, but Dan, you don't know how bad they hurt my feelings. Love one another. Ken did that well. Ken was a peacemaker in his family. Ken sought to build bridges and bring hope to hurting spots. I saw him, and I know he did it firsthand. I invite you to live as Ken did, receiving this new command where Jesus said, love one another. Jesus is speaking to his disciples. He's about to say the phrase, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Before he said that phrase, he's talking to Peter. He's talking to Philip. He's talking to some disciples, very intimately talking with him, Thomas, one of them. And Peter says to him, well, Lord, you're telling us all this stuff. Where are you going? Jesus said, I'm going away. Where are you going? Ken knows, by the way. He can see it now. Peter said, Lord, why can't I follow you there? I will lay down my life to follow you. I call all of us to this point. We sit here, Jesus, I'll lay down my life to follow you. And Jesus looked at him and said, be real careful because that rooster's going to crow three times. Some of us sitting in this room today would say, oh, I'm ready to praise the Lord. Are you ready when the rooster's crowing? Ken was. As Pastor said earlier, Jesus then looked at them and said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. Today I've come to tell you that the biggest way we will honor Ken's life is to make sure you're ready to go and live in the room God is preparing for you. Have you made that decision today? Have you invited Jesus Christ to be the Lord, the Savior of your talents, of your gifts, of your life?" Thomas said, "Lord, we don't even know where you're going. How can we know the way?" And then Jesus said, "I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. I think it's called a Believe video." On Saturday night, before Ken had passed, I was sitting in the family room with the family. The nurses and doctors were working on Ken. He was down in the room by himself and just with them there. And I stood up and I said, "I'm gonna go down and just spend a little time with Ken." I wanted to go in there and just talk to him. Ken and I have labored for the kingdom in many different settings around the country, probably both of our favorite, on a cruise ship. We've had some great times together, and I just wanted to go whisper some sweet I love yous in his ears. And as I started walking that way, Pops, I call him Pops, his dad said, I want to go sing to him. Now, I need to set this up a little bit. Y'all need to know, when I first started doing events with Ken, I asked him, very beginning, years and years ago, our family, friends, from me coming and preaching here at Res, and then I said to Ken, "I want you to do events with me around the country. I want you to do cruises with me. You sing and I'll preach." And he said, "I'll think about that." And then after he thought about it a while, he said, "I think I want to do it, but there's somebody I need you to meet first." And I'm like, "Well, man, I met Andrea, I met Kenton, I met Alyssa, I know all your family. Who do I need to meet?" He's like, "There's somebody I need you to meet." And I said, "Who?" He said, "I need you to meet my mom and my dad." And I said, "What? Your mama and your daddy?" He said, "Yeah, I need you to meet my mama and my daddy." I said, "Why?" He said, "Well, they don't quite know you and they're not real sure about you." Look at Pops. You said it, Pops. You know you did. And I said, "Okay." So they showed up at an event, and I'm not sure they liked me till after I finished preaching. And they heard me boldly saying the name of the Lord Jesus, and let me just say, I got Mom and Pop's approval, and the rest is history. And so Pops and I walked down the hallway. Pops, I would not have dreamed back in that day that I'd be doing Ken's funeral. This is not the way it's supposed to happen. A son is supposed to attend his dad's funeral, but not a dad attend his son's. We walked into that room together, and I kind of meandered over a little bit toward a chair that was against the window, and Pops came walking in. He had early swag before Kenny ever started. He swagged on in, and he said, "Kenny, I've come to sing to you. Do you remember this, Pop? I'm going to ask you to join me on stage a minute. Come right over here. I'll hold your hand. Come up here a second. I want you to go over here. It might be closer. Y'all hang on a minute. I need to bring Pops up here." So I stood there. They gave you your own microphone, didn't they?
Yeah, they said, just in case.
Like that. Just in case. I've heard that before. So I stood over against the window, and you started singing a little song. Do you remember that song?
No.
It was the song, Oh, How I Love Jesus.
Oh.
And he was just looking at Ken. And I stood there and I watched it and I thought, yep, this is called faith. When you sing and worship the Lord when you can't see the whole picture. And today, it seems only fitting that Pops would close out this time together by singing, Oh, How I Love Jesus. And let me just tell y'all, I think Ken will be singing along up in heaven. Thanks for saying yes to my friendship. And now I invite you to sing, Oh, How I Love Jesus, because we want to hear it low and solo and with some swag.
Okay, thank you, Dan. Thank you, Dan.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing His worthy sounds, just like music in my ear. Oh, it's the sweetest name on earth. Ooh, because I really love the Lord. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Him. Jesus, because He first loved me. I think of Ken, I think of Him on my shoulders, used to walk through the parks with him. Barb and I would take him. And he was such a wonderful kid. We had no problem with Ken. None. Even when he was a baby. Wonderful baby. No problems. Teenager. I still tell the people, he wanted us to go to the movies with him. As a teenager. Rest of the children too, but I figured he being the oldest, firstborn and all, he'd want to do his own thing and leave us at home. But we went everywhere together, did everything together. I don't claim that, though, for him being the child he is. You know who I give that credit to? The most wonderful wife and mother in the world, Barb. I watched her raise those kids. She's a wonderful mother. Thank you, Barb. We had a wonderful time with them. George, thank you. I knew you when you were a little baby. That's right. I saw you grow up. Thank you. Yeah. Oh, let me just say this, how I love Jesus, then I'll sit down, okay? Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, thank you, Troy. How I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he loved me a long time ago. Took me in his arms. I've seen unbelievable visions. The Lord has permitted me to see those. Ken left a wonderful, beautiful sister, Beverly. Beverly, my little girl. I'd come from work and she said she'd go into a closet and hide. She'd say, Daddy, come find me. I'm in my closet. And Troy, he actually should have been a classical musician. Yeah. And I don't know, what was he, 8 years old or something? Playing Rachmaninoff and all those people playing that classical music. Asanya, his aunt. Thank you, Asanya. Masterful musician, graduate from Michigan State. Coleman, thank you guys. Yeah. Marvis, kind of like the leader of the family. I know it's time to go, isn't it? Yes, yes. I want to thank everybody so very much. Thank you, Ann. We are here, Ann. Yes, Kenton and Alyssa. Yes, want you to come over. Kenton, we got a fish. Okay. Okay. Oh, let me say it one more time. How much I love the Lord. He walks beside me. How I love Jesus. I'll just say this and sit. Oh, I love Jesus. But I really do, though. Oh, I love Jesus. Because He fails. He loves you, Kenton. He loves you, Liz. He loves you, Ann. Granddaughters, he loves you guys. And they loved Ken so much. Ken would minister to them. I could say so much, but I've got to go and get out of the way. Thank you, Al. Wonderful. You were there at the hospital for us. Jeannie, I love to hear you pray. I love to hear you pray. I love to be in your presence when you pray.
Pastor Ben, how old are you?
I am 81.
Ben, you still got it. You still have got it. Thank you. Thank you.
Now, if you want to know who the best pastor in the world is, here he is. Oh. Thank you, Pastor. Yes, we've done a lot of fishing together, haven't we?
We have. I was just thinking about that time. You caught 9, and I got 1. Oh, this seated
so
for
much,
a moment.
Dan.
Would you please? Ken's in heaven. I know some people don't even want to go. They've got the idea that heaven is wearing a sheet, floating on a cloud, playing a harp, eating grapes, and naked babies with little bow and arrows. And the truth is, when we die before the Lord comes, we do go to that place called heaven. It's not like most people think it is. No, it's literally a city with streets and rivers and trees and furniture and food. The psalmist said that through the desert, that God gave them manna. One translation says corn from heaven. Another translation says the bread of heaven. So it must have been cornbread. But you realize there's going to be fields and crops and you're going to eat in heaven. Jesus talked about he wouldn't partake of the vine again until he did it in the kingdom of heaven. But this earth, I don't know about you, I love the earth, but it's cursed right now. But the day is coming. In Revelation 21, John said, I saw a new heaven. That's a new atmosphere and a new earth. This one's been cursed, but there's a new one coming. For the first earth and the first heaven, they'd passed away. And there was no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now, dwelling of God is with men. He'll live with them. They will be his people. God himself will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. You may not know it even as a Christian, but where we're going to spend eternity is in this brand new earth right here. Whether you're Catholic, Lutheran, Episcopalian, Holy Ghost, Pentecostal, tongue talkers, we all believe the same thing. We aren't going to live up on clouds and wear sheets. Saturday night, my wife and I were up to see Ken and the family. And while we were there, a scripture in Genesis 49 came to my mind. I just want to read this and say a couple things as we close. So Jacob is about to die. He's 147 years old. His kids
are with him. And it says, all these are the 12 tribes of Israel. He had 12 sons. And this is what their father spoke to them, and he blessed them, and he blessed each one according to his blessing. And then he charged them and said to them, I'm to be gathered to my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave that's in the field of Ephron the Hittite, in the cave that's in the field of Machpelah, which is before Mamre, in the land of Canaan, which Abraham brought with the field of Ephron the Hittite as a possession for a burial place. There, they buried Abraham and Sarah, his wife. There, they buried Isaac and Rebekah, his wife. And there, I buried Leah. Now, he knows he's about to die in a matter of a couple of hours. His whole family's around him. That's what I was thinking about when Ken was there in his bed, and Andrea was there, and Kenton, and Alicia, and Ben, and Barb, and Troy, Beverly, cousins, family. I mean, the room was packed. And there was Ken. Jacob is in a similar situation. He's about to go home to heaven. He's got all his family around him. And then he starts talking about grandpa and grandma and great-grandpa and great-grandma and his father and his mother and his wife, because he realizes, I'm leaving this part of my family, but I'm about to go and see another part of my family. And the Bible says he breathed his last. He took his feet up in his bed and was gathered to his people. He was gathered to his people. He had the earthly family around him, but he starts talking about the heavenly family. Because when a person dies, we're down here and we grieve because we're not going to see him again for a while. But when they get to heaven that fast, there's another family that's waiting for them. Their grandpa's there, grandma's there, the dead wife's there, the father, the mother are there. And Ken, we're grieving, but you know what? He's having a party in heaven. He's having a party. The Bible says it's the whole family in which heaven and earth. Some of us are here, some of us are there. And when somebody dies in the Lord, there's a group that's there waiting. And they're like, "Woo! You made it. And we have got some stuff to show you." All right, I'm going to ask if you would to bow your head for just a moment. And if you came with someone, would you please take their hand? If you're comfortable doing that, take their hand. In Psalms 58, the psalmist wrote and said, "This I know because God is for me. This I know because God is for me." You know, there are many people that I've talked to that believe God's mad at them, that God has rejected them, that they've gone too far, they've done too much, and they have missed their chance. But this is what I know. I know that God loves you. I know that God is reaching out to you by His Spirit. I know that it is not too late for you. In fact, Hebrews 4:1 says the one thing anybody should fear is that they think they missed their chance. You have not missed your ultimate opportunity to get right with God, because you have a chance today. Jesus said, "The thief, the devil, he only comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy." That's what the devil wants to do to your life. He wants to kill, he wants to steal, he wants to destroy. And why anyone would serve him one more day, I do not know. When Peter got up on the day of Pentecost and preached the first sermon the day the church was born, he said, "Be saved from this perverse generation." And what I know is that God is reaching out to you today. If you're not right with God, if you're away from God, He's reaching out to you. And He wants you to become a part of His kingdom. He does not just want to take you to heaven, but He wants to reach down on the inside of you. He wants to make you new on the inside, and He wants to rescue you today.
from the things that are trying to destroy your life. He wants to rescue you. So today, if you're away from God, the words of the Old Testament prophet Jeremiah are true about you. The Lord says, I know the thoughts that I have towards you, thoughts of peace and not evil, to give you a future and a hope, to give you a future, an eternity, a hope. You're going to be forgiven. You're going to be right with God. And he's not just talking about what's going to happen in heaven, but he's talking about today. He wants to reach down into our lives and deliver us. Now, if you're not right with God, you're away from the Lord, we're going to pray right now. And I'm going to ask you to pray this prayer out loud from your heart, everybody, right? And the Bible says that whosoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. And if you will pray this prayer from your heart, when we say amen in just a moment, you're going to be forgiven. You're going to be right with God. You're going to be a part of this family, a part of this kingdom. And you will see Ken again. So I'm going to say right now, make these words your own. Just pray this out loud. Say, oh God, I believe Jesus died on the cross. I believe his blood paid for my sins. And I believe he rose again. And I give him all of my heart and all of my life. Jesus is my king. And I'm going to live for him every day. I thank you. You've heard my prayer. That my past is gone. That I'm a part of your family. Today and forever. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now, as you're still holding that hand, if you prayed that prayer and you just came back to God, you prayed that prayer and said, I just surrendered my life to Jesus. I'm going to live for him. I'm forgiven. I'm a part of this family. If that's you, when I say three, squeeze that hand. One, two, three, squeeze that hand. I prayed that prayer. I meant it. I came back to God. Now, if someone just squeezed your hand, when I say three, would you lift it? One, two, three, lift that hand. Lift it up. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. There's got to be 30 sets of hands that are in the air. You know, Ken and I, that would every week, every time we got together, that was our prayer, that people would come back to God. Now, if you just prayed that prayer, we're not asking you to join a church, but we want to help you in your new spiritual life. And if you would text RESYES 94,000, we want to help you as you continue to follow Jesus all the days of your life.
If the sun should tumble from the sky, if the sea should suddenly run dry, he loves me, he really loves me. Let it happen, I'll be all right. All my needs he promised to provide. Nothing good from me will he deny. Jesus loves me, he really loves me. Let it happen, I'll be all right. He never failed me yet. All of my needs he's already met. Through the storms and winds harvest. If I supply the vain, yields the good, the rest. All my needs He promised to provide. Nothing good from me will He deny. You see, He loves me. He really loves me. Let it happen. Whatever happened, let it happen. I'll be alright. Gonna be alright. Gonna be alright.
Alright.
Gonna be alright.
Alright.
I'm gonna be alright. Let it happen. Whatever happened. Just let it happen. Gonna be
alright.
It never failed me yet. All of my needs is already met. Through the storms of life, with each passing test, if I supply the faith, Jesus will do the rest. All my needs He promised to provide. Nothing good from me will He deny. He loves me. He really loves me. Let it happen. Whatever happened, let it happen. Gonna be alright. Gonna be alright.
Alright.
You'll be alright.
Alright.
You're gonna be alright.
Alright.
Everything is gonna be alright.
All
right. Let it happen. Whatever happened, let it happen. Gonna be alright.